Marvelous name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I take this opportunity to wish all of you a very happy, healthy and holy new year. May the Lord bless each one of us so that this year will be a really happier year than the last year, healthier year than the last year, and holier year than the last year. Amen. An ill-prepared student went to the exam hall to write his exam. Since he was not prepared well enough, he didn't know the answers to the questions that were asked to him. But this guy was a smart guy, and more so it was a holy day season. So this is what he thought to write. God knows all the answers. Merry Christmas, dear teacher. And the teacher saw the answer sheet. Time for him to grade them. So teacher thought, let me also outsmart my student. So he said, God gets 100. You get 0. Happy New Year. Well, I'm here not to wish you the fake Happy New Year. Well, come at the New Year, come at the time for taking resolution. What is resolution? Resolution is a promise to make yourself to start something good or to stop something bad as we begin the new year. We want to improve our behavior, our lifestyle in some way. There are many examples. Some want to shed their weight. Some want to kick their bad habits. If you are a good Christian, then you will try to probably read more Bible, more than ever before. Maybe you would like to pray more than ever before. So practically speaking, today is the day many people, many Christians likely to come up with some resolutions in their lives. Well, it might help them to an extent accomplishing goal sets by them, but most they fail to live by them. Interestingly enough, some have, in fact majority of the people, have become very cynical about making resolutions in the new year. Let's see some few cynical thoughts about new year resolution. I like to present before you two thoughts. Number one, someone said a New Year resolution is something that goes in one ear and out at the other. What does this mean? This means whoever make resolution, they are not serious about it. Others said, I think of daily resolutions, not yearly resolution. That means people have started becoming negative about taking resolution. This morning, I'm here to tell you that God is interested in, not in our resolution, but He is interested in our revolution. I repeat, God is not more interested in our resolution. He is rather more interested in our revolution. My friends, we need revolution in two aspects of our lives, as per the text that we have read this morning. God says, well, I want you to change your lifestyle. I want you to change your thought pattern. I want you to change your perspective. So as per Apostle Paul, he wanted the believers at Thessalonica to revolutionize their lives. So there are two things that I want to present before you as far as revolution is concerned. Number one says revolution in our relational life. Revolution in our relational life. Number two, revolution in our spiritual life. We will do well if you think about changing our life, our relationship, how we relate with others. It is very important because we live in a society, we live in community. We are not alone. We are social being, we are social animal. We need one another. And more so in Christian society, we are dependent on each other. We are asked to love one another, care for one another, help one another, lift up one another. There are so many things that we do when we live in our community. So it is important that we change our relational life. It is important that we change our spiritual life, because we do believe that we need to grow spiritually day by day, year by year. There should be always a burning desire in our heart to grow one step further. So let us first see revolution in our relational life. What does Apostle Paul says? Now, there are two categories that Apostle Paul makes here in the text. The first category of people that he makes is people who are in the leadership, spiritual leadership. In the church, you know, there are two groups of people. They are called clergymen and laity. Now, the relationship between clergymen and laity are very, very crucial. We cannot underestimate the relationship. And that's why Apostle Paul thought it was important for him to address the need of maintaining a very good relationship, good rapport with people who are in spiritual authority or leadership. Now he says, in relationship to the pastor, or in relationship to the people who shepherd you, who look after your spiritual well-being, how do you relate with them? Let's see what Apostle Paul has to say to us this morning. He says, and we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourself. Now there are three commands Apostle Paul gives to the believers, the members of the church. As far as the relationship with the pastor and the leaders are concerned, the first thing that he says that we got to change our mindset. What do you do? We recognize them. Well, this is not talking about facial recognition, saying that, hey, this is my pastor, or this is my elder, this is my secretary. It is not talking about facial recognition. This is talking about appreciating their toil for the Lord. This is about admiring, commending the work that they ought to do. And this ought to be a sincere appreciation for the kind of work, labor they put in order to shape up your spiritual life. Now, how many churches today across Orissa are serious about really recognizing the labor put in by their pastors, their church leaders? They take them for granted. They take them for granted. They undermine their efforts. We hardly appreciate them. Thankfully, once in a year, in Western country, they have recognized, set apart a Sunday, calling it as a Pastor's Appreciation Sunday. But how many of us really have that kind of appreciation towards our spiritual leaders who pray over you, who pray for your well-being, who wants to get involved in your spiritual life? Who wants to shape up your thoughts? Who wants to shape up your career? Who wants to shape up your spiritual life? Do you really recognize their labor? We are doing pretty well, but there is so much more that we need to do as church in order to recognize, appreciate the work of our leaders who take care of the spiritual well-being of our church. It should come spontaneously from our heart. It's more than recognizing their face. It's more than identifying them. You must be full of appreciation for them, for what they do, because they are there to build up your life. So Apostle Paul moves to the second injunction, saying the members of the church must respect them, esteem them, value them, and they must be valued very highly. Apostle Paul uses a very strong word that you must have highest respect for your spiritual authority. That is what Bible expects from each one of us. I don't know what kind of attitude you have, but as far as Bible is concerned, as far as Apostle Paul is concerned, he is very serious about it. And he says that, well, learn to give highest respect to your pastors, to your leaders. It is not some respect, it is not somehow respect, but it is the highest respect. And that is what is going to display your maturity in the Lord. Whether you are a serious Christian or not, whether you are a Christian who wants to transform your thinking or not, can be measured by this. Whether or not you have highest regard for your spiritual authority. How often we think, well, people are in the ministry because they have nothing to do. My friend, there may be people who are in the ministry by their own will. But we are in the service of the Lord because God has called us. And that's why we are available 24/7 to serve the people of God. I'm reminded of one incident that took place here a couple of months back. A non-Christian friend who holds a very high position in the society brought a housemaid who was possessed by a demon. At that time I was working on my sermon and it was close to 12 o'clock. They went to the capital hospital for treatment. The doctor said, you better go to unit 4 church. The pastor will pray and she will be healed. Isn't it amazing? So they literally brought that demon possessed lady, dragging her to our doorpost. And rang the bell and I immediately opened. I knew something wrong waiting for me. But I see a lady possessed by demon. Her hands were just bent like that. Her feet were bent. She was unable to stand. She needed the help of two men to hold her stand upright. And this is what I heard that gentleman say, Pastor, why don't you pray? It was suggested by the doctor himself that when you pray, she will be completely healed. I say, that is true. I have no power, but the one whom I serve has the power. He can certainly do it. You won't believe. I just prayed a simple prayer and then the lady got healed. And her two feet, two hands started becoming straight. She was unable to speak and immediately she started saying, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Praise the Lord. You know, one thing that gentleman who happens to be an IS officer, he said, young man, I appreciate you for what you do here in this church. Because we have come in a wrong time to wake you up from the sleep. But I thank you that you are more than willing to give our time for us. And he folded his hand That should be spontaneous. That's what Apostle Paul means when he says, appreciate your pastor, give the highest regard for your pastor. And that is always expected from each one of us. The third thing that Apostle Paul says is that be in peace with them. Never be at loggerhead with them. Never be in conflict with your spiritual leader. No matter what, whatever may be the reason, don't ever create any animosity with them. Be friendly with them so that they will be able to serve you the best way possible. We should, as member of the church, never become a stumbling block. Never become a stumbling block. Rather, we should be a stepping stone so that they will be able to serve you to the best of their ability. So that is what we need to revolutionize, change. Our relationship towards our spiritual leaders must get change. And particularly Union Church, because this is a church in our state people look up to. They want to learn from us. They want to emulate us. When that happens here, I tell you, it will spread. It will be contagious everywhere. And there will be a complete transformation the way we look at your spiritual leaders. The second thing Apostle Paul says is that revolution in our relationship in relation to other members of the church. Well, church is a beautiful community because there is no discrimination in the church. No rich and poor, no discrimination between rich and poor, educated, uneducated, black and white, intelligent, unintelligent. When you come to the church, in the sight of God, we are all the same. We all leave our social status at home and you come here. You leave it out, not even home. You leave your social status at your office and come here. When you are here, you are a sinner saved by grace before God. And there are varieties of, you know, people, believers you will find, members you find in the church. And you need to understand them. You know what he says? He says, now I exhort you. First he said, I exhort you to improve your relationship with your spiritual leaders. Secondly, he says, my brethren, I want to tell you how to relate with other members of your family, of your church. There are different kinds of believers. There are believers who are unruly, very disorderly. They are believers, but they don't want to be under any authority, any rules and regulation. Then there are believers who have zeal, but they are very weak, faint-hearted believers. And there are also believers who are not very matured spiritually. That's why sometimes many of our believers, new ones, they do not follow the word of God. What is being preached here, they don't understand a thing. The reason, they are new to our faith. They are new to our faith. They read the Bible, they don't understand. They are not able to make head or tail of what they read. And that's why it is important that we as members of the body of Christ understand other members. So what do? He says, when you find an unruly, a disorderly member in the church, ignore them. That's what the world will teach you. The world will teach you, hey, he is unruly, just leave him alone. Sorry. That is not what should be done in the church. In the church, when somebody is found to be unruly, when somebody is not in line with the scripture, when somebody is out of line, out of tune with God, it is my duty, it is your duty to bring them so that they might come in line with the word of God. Our responsibility is to restore them. Our responsibility is to make their life orderly so that they also come along with us. So it is very important. Let us not ignore the unruly. Let us warn them and say, hey, this, what you do is not right in the eyes of the Lord. The way you do things is not right. You need to mend your ways. You need to repair your ways. You need to repent from your sin. We should never let him go in his own way. So unruly brothers must be warned, not ignored. Secondly, he says, comfort the faint-hearted. The ministry of comfort is never to be underestimated. There are so many inside the church who feel hopeless, who feel lonely, who feel abandoned, who needs our comfort. And they need to be comforted. They need to be, they need to be lifted up. Especially those who are not very mature. Oh, I thought that church will be a heavenly place. It's like heaven-like place. But I find things so strange. We are not able to digest each other. We are not able to tolerate each other. So what do I do? Well, let me find some other church. First reaction is find some other church. You go there, you see the same thing. You said, no, this is not good one. Let me find another one. You jump from one church to another, you find no perfect church. You know where the problem lies? The problem lies within us. Those kind of believers need to be comforted and encouraged. Ministry of encouragement is very much essential in the church. So when one of our brothers falls down, it is the duty of the church to lift them up. When one of our brothers or sister feels hopeless, it is our duty to give them hope, him or her hope. That's what Apostle Paul says. So we must change our relations with other members of the church. After warning them, we have to comfort them. And then we have to hold them, lift them up, carry them, bear their burden. If you see that somebody is overburdened, they're unable to walk, they're unable to move on with their lives, we need to be there, right there, to carry their burden, to share their burden, to help them in the journey of faith so that they proceed for there. And the fourth thing that he says is be patient with them. We people are so impatient. How many times should I tolerate this guy? How many times should I tolerate this sister? How many times should I tolerate this brother? Enough is enough. That is what we say. But Bible says that we need to be patient with people. Praying for them so that their life would be transformed, that they would change, that they would mature in their faith. And that's why we are asked to be patient with our brothers and sisters. And the fifth thing is that we need to be kind with them. When somebody does something wrong, if somebody tells hurtful things to us, what do? We immediately tend to retaliate them. We say, eye for an eye, teeth for teeth, or tit for tat, whatever. But Bible says, see that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always be kind, do good to others. In this new year, let this be our revolution. Let this be in our mind that I will be patient with people, that I will be kind to people no matter what they say to me, no matter what they do to me. That when I see my brother and sister doing something wrong, I will pray for them and I will approach them and tell them not to repeat the mistake, not to continue in that sin. When I see a feeble brother or sister, fearful brother or sister, I'll go and encourage them. I'll comfort them. And I will lift them up and help them move forward. That takes us to the second revolution. Revolution in our spiritual life. Verses 16 through 20. Our spiritual life is not measured by how many times we read the Bible, how many times we go to church, how many times we go to church in a week. That doesn't determine our maturity, spiritual maturity. How many times we pray in a day does not reflect our maturity in Christ. They are mere spiritual activities. Activities are not spirituality, mind you. Here is the real measure, spiritual measure that we have. The real measures are here. There are five measures to know whether or not we are spiritually maturing. Number one is joyful life. Let this year be a year where you remain joyful throughout. Throughout. A joyful life says, rejoice always. Rejoice always. God wants us to be joyful at all times. It is important why Apostle Paul used always, all time. Christian joy does not spring from circumstances. I repeat, Christian joy does not come from circumstances. It comes from the blessings that we have in Christ Jesus. Look at the position you are in Christ Jesus. That is what will make you joyful throughout the year. When a Christian remains in sadness and depression, that is a violation of commandment. When you remain sad, when you remain depressed, you break the commandment of God. And the kind of joy that Apostle Paul is talking about is the joy that of Job. Having lost everything, he worshipped God. This joy is that of Apostle Paul, who was in prison and rise to the believer saying, rejoice always. Again I say, rejoice. This is the joy the Lord wants us to enjoy throughout the year 2018. That is what maturity is all about. A joyful life. Leading a joyful life no matter what the circumstances are. The second is, he says, pray without ceasing. Never stop praying. Never stop praying. I know we all pray. And I know also when you pray, right? As soon as we get up, we pray. Before we have food, we pray. These are all ritualistic prayer. Prayer is dependence on God. He says, Apostle Paul says, never cease to pray. It is easier to pray again and again when things go well with us, when things go as planned. Paul is talking about an attitude of prayer, maintaining consistent communion with God. Why does he say pray non-stop, pray without ceasing? Because when we pray and when there is no answer, we stop praying. When do you stop praying? When there is no answer to our prayer. When do you stop praying? When there is delayed answer, we stop praying. When do you stop praying? We stop praying when things become very worse. I am reminded of a person. When he was asked to pray, he suddenly reacted saying, how dare you ask me to pray? Don't you know what has happened to my life? Don't you know there are disasters after disaster that has struck my life? Don't you know that I have lost my son? Don't you know that I have lost my daughter? Don't you know that I have lost my wife? How dare you ask me to pray? And then that happens to be my father-in-law in our own home. Man who served the church as a secretary, man who served the Lord in various capacity in the church, time might come when you have no words in your mouth to pray. You have no more desire to pray to the Lord because of what has happened to your life. That's why Apostle Paul says, pray without ceasing. Whether there is answer or not, whether there is delayed answer, and regardless of the situation, we need to keep praying. So let us not give up praying on anything that we start praying. The third spiritual measure is thankful life. Thankful life. In everything, give thanks. Look at the adjective, the qualification. In everything, it is easier to be thankful when all is well. But is it possible to give thanks when all is not well? Bible says, be thankful, give thanks to God in your joy, give thanks to God in your sorrow, give thanks to God in your prosperity, give thanks to God in your adversity. Give thanks to God in the house of God, and give thanks to God even when you are on the sick bed. God says, the Lord tells us this morning as we begin, kick off this new year, remain ever thankful to God for everything. Don't ever say, I don't have. Don't ever say, I don't get. Don't ever say, I am not in your position. Because thanklessness is a trait of an unbeliever. Listen very carefully. Thanklessness is a trait of an unbeliever, whereas thankfulness is a trait of a believer, my friend. So if you and I are believer in the Lord, and that too a mature believer in the Lord, we should be ever grateful to the Lord for what you are, where you are, how you are. Let's be thankful to God throughout the year. The fourth spiritual measure is a spirit-led life. A spirit-led life. Verse 19. Do not quench the spirit. The Bible compares the Holy Spirit with flame. Holy Spirit is like a flame. What does flame do? What does the fire do? The fire warms us. So also the Holy Spirit warms our heart. The Holy Spirit enlightens our mind. The Holy Spirit empowers us, energizes us, strengthens us. And when the Holy Spirit is at work in our life, never ever try to suppress the Holy Spirit. You know why we suppress the Holy Spirit? Because we want our spirit to take precedence over the Holy Spirit. We want our desire to be fulfilled rather than God, the desire of the Holy Spirit. We want our direction to come to pass rather than the direction of the Holy Spirit. But my friend, let us have a spirit-led life where our life is completely submitted to the leading, control, and guidance of the Holy Spirit. Where you can say, it is not by might, but it is by your spirit, O Lord. Paul said, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be controlled by the Holy Spirit. When the Spirit of God works in your life to change something, to adapt something, to give up something, prompts you to do something, compels you to do something, maybe to pray, maybe to read the Bible, maybe to help somebody, maybe to comfort somebody, never ever resist the leading of the Holy Spirit, the prompting of the Holy Spirit. it is very easy for us to reject the leading of the Holy Spirit in our life. Yes, the Spirit of God dwells in us. But as long as you and I do not allow the Spirit to transform us, to lead us, to take control of our life, the Holy Spirit is not going to do it. We need to allow, we need to submit ourselves. May this year be a year where we allow the Spirit to guide us. We allow the Spirit to give us the direction. We allow the Spirit to give us wisdom. We allow the Spirit to give us the understanding. And show us the way to go, rather than we depend upon our wisdom. The last but not the least, do not despise the prophecies. Our spiritual maturity is measured by a scripture-led life. This is what. We must allow our lives, our thoughts, our faith, our belief system to be governed by the Word of God. This is our ultimate authority. All authority comes from the Word of God, not from the Google. Don't go to Google and find something, oh, this is ultimate. This is the ultimate. What we have in Google is contributed by us only. So you will not find the manna from heaven. You will find it from here. All the spiritual guidance comes from the Word of God, and your life, my life, must be guided by the scripture. And interestingly, he says, despise. Don't despise the Word of God. Isn't it? Doesn't it sound funny? How can a Christian despise the Word of God? Prophecy here means the Word of God. It could be oral or it could be written. But now that we have the written record of the revelation of God, do not despise the Word of God. How does a Christian despise the Word of God? I tell you, when you undermine the Word of God, when you devalue the Word of God, when we say, Word of God is not everything for me, we treat it with contempt. And how do you treat with contempt? When we don't read it, when you don't study it, when we don't practice it. May we all say like David, the Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. May that be our slogan this year. Lord, I know practicing your Word is very difficult, but with your grace, I can practice it. Sometime following the Word of God is very funny, very strange. People may think that you are a crazy guy. You are an insane person doing things. But that doesn't matter what people say about us, what they say about us. What matters is whether or not we comply ourselves to the scripture. I have heard people say, you know, they did in their times, why should you do it? Somewhere I was taking a seminar, a leadership seminar. And one thing I was saying, don't ever go to court. Church, don't ever go to court for solution. The solution is here in the Word of God. To go to court is sin. And one of the leaders stood up. How can you say this, sir? Without that, there is no solution. That is your problem. That is what you think. But that what you are doing is not right. Well, we cannot do it. Well, if you are determined not to do it, I am handicapped. I can't help you. There are things that might be very difficult for us to do, but never impossible for us to do. Let our life, let our thoughts, let our imagination, let all our doings be guided by the scripture. So this morning we have seen two things. No resolution, but revolution. Revolution in our relationship, with the pastors, with the leaders, with fellow men and women, fellow member of the church, revolution in our spiritual life. May the Lord help us that we may lead in this new year with a changed life where God will be honored and we will be happy in the Lord.